Distinguished delegates, with those few words, I now have the honor to declare that the International Conference on Safeguarding African World Heritage as a Driver of Sustainable Development is officially opened. Asante sana kwa kunisikiliza. Thank you very much.
Development since the early years of independence to now has yielded a lot of economic growth, but economic growth does not mean development, and development can be there also without being very sustainable. What we think the conference should really strive for is get African communities who are living in and around World Heritage sites really to be the drivers for changes in attitude, in behavior, in developmental aspirations, so that we can reach a stage where communities would not be any more excluded from the sites.
Based on my research, I found that the community did not feel that they owned the heritage, which also led to how they perceived it and breaking minor laws here and then, which in the long run, more damage can actually be done to the site by untrained people than actually by the actual visitors themselves. So just perhaps an appeal to the heritage sector within our country that we really have to come together to make ourselves more visible about what our sector is about, and to really try to make sure that the local communities benefit from this World Heritage status, not just in terms of being employed as local guides, but to really have real involvement and also to bring primary services to these people, such as primary health care, primary education, and the like.
I've already looked at examples where we have community benefits going to the from the park. From tourism, we have had a lot of money that has gone to the park, both at administrative local governments and at the local level, where money is going to the household level. We have seen a lot of revenue going to government from power generation to agriculture and other sectors.
Si l'on considère le déficit en logement, le déficit en bâtiments publics, en écoles, en dispensaires, etc., pour lesquels on a beaucoup de peine à trouver des financements, on pourrait plus facilement construire tous ces éléments, ces édifices manquants, si l'on prenait mieux en compte ou si l'on utilisait les ressources locales. On voit aujourd'hui de jeunes architectes africains qui ont compris qu'il était possible de faire de beaux bâtiments en terre, en pierre ou en d'autres ressources, et nous encourageons vivement les gouvernements à leur donner la possibilité de poursuivre ces efforts-là en facilitant l'accès aux matériaux locaux, évidemment en transformant aussi le système éducatif, en enseignant pas seulement le métal et le béton comme matériaux de base de construction, mais en leur montrant aussi qu'il est possible d'utiliser d'autres ressources. Et je pense que si les ingénieurs et architectes d'aujourd'hui avaient de meilleures connaissances de ce qui s'est passé depuis les siècles dans les zones rurales africaines et même dans les villes, si je pense à Djéné ou Tombouctou, ils seraient capables de faire de très beaux bâtiments contemporains avec un coût économique, un coût environnemental beaucoup plus raisonnable qu'aujourd'hui.
We believe that environmental sustainability can be achieved and can contribute more to government income, more government development projects than the use of these parks for other areas, especially if we use it for agriculture. It will be less productive than when we use it for conservation. If governments come up with proper policies and come up with proper strategies and they invest in conservation, we should be able to generate more money that's going to the economy on a sustainable basis.
I would like to appeal to our various African governments to seriously consider supporting creative initiatives at heritage sites to meet the needs of local communities. Without their support, we will not be able to do it. And also, I would like to appeal also to the private sector, because normally they come up with creative solutions which are not within the reach of our practices, the heritage practitioners. And we are also, I'm just appealing to them so that they can come and partner with us at our various heritage sites in Africa, sit down with the communities, look at projects that we can do that are sustainable, that also lead to conservation.
It is important to, you know, bring together, you know, partners such as the private sector in that role, and also the civil society. So I was talking about a project that has been sponsored by the Diamond Trust, which is a fund created by the, you know, the Botswana and De Beers, a private companies in Botswana, and also the role of the NGO in facilitating the community, you know, to, you know, get involved in the project. So my argument is that we need to work together, you know, as stakeholders, so that we can get benefits from, you know, African heritage and be able to contribute to the, you know, improvement of livelihoods of rural communities. So it is important for us to work together in that respect.
C'est à nous, à notre génération, de tirer le maximum de profit des connaissances qui sont enfouies dans ce patrimoine, de le valoriser, de l'archiver et de le conserver afin de le transmettre aux générations futures.
It's been difficult to manage the national park because of past frictions that has existed between the communities and then the park. So this policy or this framework allows communities to become co-managers of the site and also enjoy benefits directly and indirectly from other activities related to the management. And this has brought a lot of benefits to the community and also to the site, and has empowered the communities in issues relating to natural resource governance, livelihood issues, and conservation, biodiversity, and so forth. So I want to especially encourage the youth within these communities to see this as their own, and also be actively involved in every activity that that there should be, as a direct benefit, you know, to conservation and also to the development of their livelihoods and also their economic development.
Aujourd'hui, nous devons repenser le mode de gouvernance de ces patrimoines. Nous devons repenser et réapprendre à vivre pleinement ces patrimoines, et c'est ce que nous essayons de faire avec le projet AfriCap 2016. Nous menons des projets pilotes, nous les utilisons pour renforcer les capacités, pour développer des méthodes adaptées aux réalités locales, et aussi pour tirer des argumentaires pour motiver encore d'autres projets, et des projets porteurs de développement.
For sustainability to be here in conservation and also for the benefit of communities, we have to think of the three pillars of sustainability, which are: you can have economic growth. When you have economic growth, then you can have inclusivity and social development, as well as ecological maintenance of the richness and also the peculiarities of the sites. And it's important that we keep these three components together in any of the natural resources as well as World Heritage Sites. From there, you could get broad community support to what you're doing, fight what is encroachment or maybe natural phenomena which are really threatening the viability of the site.
Virunga National Park, which is at the same time a World Heritage Site. It's an exceptional park. It's one of the greatest parks on Earth in terms of the richness of its ecosystems, in terms of landscape and species diversity. But these are also very, very threatened. So the elephant population has collapsed over that period, as have the hippos. It's been one of the greatest periods of wildlife depletion in Africa. And as a consequence, with a team of Congolese professionals, we've had to try and work on a strategy to counter those pressures. We've been confronted with the necessity to continue the conservation effort, even during periods of armed conflict. And we've also been confronted with resource extraction issues, illegal resource extraction issues, that require a very robust legal framework to be able to work through. And that's really what the convention has offered us, because it's inscribed not just as an international convention, but also under Congolese law. And so it gives us the legal basis to be able to continue the conservation work, even when confronted with very major challenges like armed conflict or the illegal exploitation of oil, which are the two big challenges that we've faced in recent years. Both of them have in many ways been confronted, and in many ways positively. The oil company that was illegally exploring for oil has left, and many of the species that we find in Virunga, in spite of the violence and the conflict, are beginning to show signs of recovery.
In Tanzania, World Heritage Sites, at least three of them, contribute significantly to wildlife tourism in this country. And wildlife tourism is number one in economic earner in Tanzania. And this is because of the contribution of the three World Heritage Sites of Kilimanjaro National Park, Ngorongoro Conservation Area, and Serengeti National Park. So sincerely, the World Heritage Sites are drivers for sustainable development in this country.
If I want to say, to take this picture, a broader picture, and sustainable development, especially of World Heritage, then you need to look back our history. Are we really integrating the knowledge, indigenous knowledge of community and the conservation for sustainable development or not? There are a lot of intrinsic culture of community adjacent to Serengeti National Park, adjacent to Masai Mara, for example, around Loliondo Game Reserve, inside Ngorongoro Conservation Area, around Tarangire and Manyara National Park. There is intrinsic knowledge which is not capitalized to be viable for social economy of the society. And therefore, you cannot mention sustainable development if you cannot integrate this kind of knowledge with what we call the conservation philosophy from, you know, colonial perspective. Can you imagine, for example, if I can ask any journalist or any person, is there any part of your body, if you remove it, then your body will still work properly, for example? If you answer that question, you get an answer to sustainable development on World Heritage Sites.
In 1961, our first president made it very clear that we are protecting World Heritage Sites, specifically not to Tanzanians alone, but for the whole world. And that's why we made a very, very right choice to be part of the World Heritage Site community.
I take this opportunity now to declare the Ngorongoro Declaration on Safeguarding African World Heritage as a driver of sustainable development has been adopted today here in Ngorongoro, Tanzania, 4th June 2016.